and bin Laden's strongholds. It could take weeks for them to return. Nothing is certain.
When you leave Pakistan and want to go to Afghanistan, you're allowed to do that. But if you want to come back to Pakistan, the Pakistan government has banned the entry of new refugees.
In America, with each wave of Irish emigration, songs and ballads arrived. The Irish brought their music to farmland and city, to Texas cattle ranges, and to Wisconsin lumber camps. As Irish emigrants took on new American identities, so too did their music. This was to have a profound impact on the way popular song culture developed in America. Irish songs and ballads were absorbed into American popular music. The result was to be heard in music halls, on concert platforms, on radio, and in commercial recordings.
A lot of the music from over there influenced songs over here that you would never dream of. Songs like, I'm sitting here sighing and rocking the cradle, rocking the baby that's none of my own, which was supposed to have been a song about the Holy Family. Well, it came over here and got as far as Texas, I think, and they would sing songs like, get along, little doggy, get along on your trail. You know that Wyoming will be your new home, based on that. Songs like The Bard of Armagh, the tune was picked up and became one of the best-known cowboy songs in America, The Streets of Laredo. So I walked out in the streets of Laredo. It, in turn, influenced one of the great blues songs called the St. James Infirmary Blues. So there was a thread tying all of them together.
Tommy Makem emigrated to America from the small town of Cady in County Armagh. The community into which he was born entertained itself through music making. His mother, Sarah, was a well-known singer, and his father, Peter, played the fiddle. When the song collector Jean Ritchie arrived in Ireland in 1952, she discovered in this community an important source of the traditional music of her home place in the Appalachians.
My music collection is extensive. I've got, as I say, miles of tapes, but I think that the collection I did of people, of knowing people, was even better. And that's something that you can't put down on paper. We went into Sarah Makem's kitchen, and she would just took us right in and started to slice bacon. I have a wonderful recording of her getting supper or tea for us while she's singing and talking to us. And she's singing, you can hear the knife going through the bread, rah, 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 and then she can hear the bacon sizzling, and all the time she is singing, as I went out on a May morning right early.
As I roved out on a May morning right early. I met my love upon the way, oh Lord, but she was early.
I kept listening to it and smelling the bacon and being reminded of something. And what it reminded me of, finally I thought of it, was a play game that we played back home. It's called Old King Cole Was a Jolly Old Soul. And it used almost the same tune that she was using. So that's how the music got there. Sometimes the words were changed, but the tune remained the same. They had a way of keeping the Irish tunes mostly, and because the Irish tunes were far superior, of course. Old King Cole. Old King Cole was a jolly old soul, and that you may know by his learning. He eat cornbread till his head turned red, and his old yellow cap needs darning. My pretty little pink, I once did think that I and you would marry. But now I've lost all hopes of you, and I ain't got long to tarry.
Boots was black and her stockings white, and her buckles shone like silver. She had and a rolling eye and her earrings tipped her shoulder. And she sung lilt-a-doodle, lilt-a-doodle, lilt-a-doodle day, and she idled on the day.
Sarah Makem opened her store of songs for the many music collectors who visited Ireland in the 50s. Irish folk song had gone on, unrecognised abroad, and taken for granted at home, even in the small local communities where it flourished.
Deanne Hamilton came to Ireland to collect folk music as well. She had known Paddy and Tom Clancy in New York and went to visit with the Clancy's mother and father in Carrickenshire in County Tipperary. And Liam was there, a young whippersnapper, and she was coming up to Katy to collect some songs from my mother. And at that time, of course, that would have been in the 50s, the recording equipment was huge and very heavy, and he came along on the trip to sort of carry the recording equipment, and he and I met in Katy, and we went off to a Cayley in the town hall in Newry that first night we were there. And but that's when Liam and I met, and then we discovered we were both coming to the United States.
For the love of one's country is a terrible thing.
Popular music keeps changing and frequently borrows from what went before. Its themes are universal. Continuity and change become partners in a living tradition.
And it makes us all part of the Patriot Game.
The Patriot Game was written by Dominic Behan, but it was originally a song from the Appalachian Mountains. One morning, one morning, one morning in May, I overheard a married man to a young girl say, oh, cause something pretty say, Rowan, come along with me across the blue mountains to the Allegheny. And then it became a popular song, was slightly adapted by a popular singer of the day named Joe Stafford, who called it the Bold Grenadier or something.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And it was in that popular recording that Dominic Behan took the tune and he made it into the Patriot Game. Come all you young rebels and list while I sing. For the love of one's country is a terrible thing. And of course, we used to sing this with great passion at the folk clubs in the village. And among the patrons, young singer, songwriter, came into town named Bob Dylan. And he transformed it, of course, into With God on Our Side. And it's since has made the full round.
Oh, my name, it means nothing. And my age, it means less. For the country I come from, it's called the Midwest.
8 and 7. 8 legs.
I was taught and brought up to get lost to a battle. That the land that I live in has God on it.
There was always this thing about, are you destroying traditional Irish folk music? Do you have the right to take those liberties, you see? And what we did with the songs is what's been done over the generations. You adapt them to your own. The folk singers who picked them up in the cottages and the fields, they changed them to suit themselves. And should anybody freeze them at any particular generation of their development, it would be stupid. But we weren't involved in that. We weren't answerable to anybody. In fact, we were out making a living out of something we loved doing.
We used to go over to the White Horse Tavern on Hudson Street and sing there. There was no singing allowed. And the barman would come into the back room every once in a while and say, no singing allowed here. So everyone would stop, and then he would go out, and as soon as he got behind the bar, everybody would start to sing again. And then he'd come in an hour later, no singing allowed, and go back. And but it, a lot of singing went on there, and a whole bunch of them came down to this theater, and we sang these drinking songs. Then people started offering us jobs singing and offering us money to sing, and we were corruptible. Took the money and ran like hell.
Up on his knee, a pretty wench, I had on the table a jug of punch.
What they did at the time when they went to America, it was a new continent, you know. Ireland went downhill in the 1940s and 50s. There was huge, desolate emigration in the 1950s. Then the Clancy brothers came back wearing, in front of the records, they were wearing dress suits. They were coming out of Carnegie Hall with dress suits and an Aran jersey over their arm, you know. It was terrific, you know. The Irish had arrived in some way. And they also associated Irish music with a thing called success.
Upon my heart,
they never left.
Even the cripple forgets his hunch when he's snug outside
of a jug of punch.
And
for me, it was the fact that I was being more excited by Irish music than I had been previously by American and British rock and roll. Like, suddenly I discovered this music that I found as exciting and more exciting than the stuff I've been listening to previous to that.
And if I get the rock, well, the money's me own, and them that don't like me, they can lay me alone. I'll tune me fiddle, and I'll rosin me bow, and I'll be well.
Only now have I become interested again in the story songs and the folk tradition. I love the Clancy brothers, sure enough. I love the Clancy brothers. Liam Clancy is one of the great ballad singers.
And I'll be welcome wherever I go. And when I'm dead, I ain't in my grave. No costly tombstone will I have. Just lay me down in my native peat. With a jug of...
In some way, even though I'm not very familiar with the Clancy brothers, I feel very much like them. Except that I did what they did, but I did it in the 80s. And what's interesting about it is that I notice an awful lot of younger, newer Irish immigrants, legal and illegal, coming to my gigs and in some way identifying with my show and my songs.
Just lay me down in my native peat, where there's got a punch at my head and feet.
Shut up again there, my...
Some summer around 60 or 61 or 62, in between me listening to The Shadows and that sort of stuff, Cliff Richard and Radio Luxembourg and all, suddenly people were actually talking about a group called the Clancy Brothers and that they were real big in America and it was great and fine girl you are and, you know, and they're Brennan on the Moor and all these Irish songs are, you know. So I was not really musically disposed initially to that kind of thing, but like there was such a sort of vibe surrounding the Clancy Brothers that I suppose my chauvinist hackles were raised and I'd be going, oh, the Clancy Brothers are Irish, blah, blah, they're making a big... I suppose I should find out what all this is about.
America is not the only destination chosen by Irish immigrants. Over the past few centuries, several million have made their way to England in search of work. Traditionally, the Irish in England have laboured in construction, mining, and factory work. Their experience of life in England was frequently one of racial isolation and discrimination. Unlike America, there was no melting pot in England. Irish music did not find its way into the mainstream of popular music in that country. It remained ghettoised.
When I landed in England, my God, the more every one of them, not the majority or the minority, every one of them took the rise out of you. But I'll ask you one thing. Go down to Camden Town in the morning. Go to the Brecknock in the morning. Go to the Nag's Head just here on the Seven Sisters Road. Go up to the Archway. and ask me who is jumping on the wagons, who is doing the work in this country, they're all Irishmen. Every one of them, they're Irish contractors and they're Irish labour. And I've heard Englishmen to say, and English women, my God, are they not savage? When they used to see the lads with their vest off, not knowing them with just the trousers, but them lads couldn't help it, they were working hard.
I kind of lived in an Irish, I suppose, ghetto area of sort of Kilburn, Wilsdon area, and like the places I used to go all the time, I used to associate with Irish people all the time. I didn't know any English people. We went to Irish bars, we went to the White Hart in Fulham on a Sunday morning and we played Irish music. We went to, you know, a pub up on Holloway Road, can't remember the name of it now. And, you know, it was the feeling that you were second-class citizen, I suppose, that I felt very strongly. And I kind of didn't like that feeling at all. Not a little bit.
Just about 19 when I landed on the shore with my eyes big as headlights, like the thousands and thousands who came before. I was gonna be something. Smile of the mind scrutinized on my face as I walked down over the gangway. I came down to their city where I worked for many a year, built 100 houses. Must have pulled off 1,000,000 pints of beer, living under suspicion, putting up with the hate and the fear in their eyes. You can see that you're nothing but a murderer. Yeah, in their eyes, we're nothing but a bunch of murderers. Say, hey, Johnny, can't wait till Saturday night. Got a thirst that's raging, and no place where we can put that right. Wash away the confusion, hose down these flames inside. But look out, that's right, I said look out, cause I'll tear you into pieces if you cross me. I'm sick of watching them break up every time some bird brain puts us down, making jokes on the radio. I guess it helps them all drown out the sound, the crumbling foundations. Any fool could see the writings on the wall, but they just don't believe that it's happening. No, no. Too bad. Well, there's a crowd says I'm all right. See, they like my turn of phrase. Take me round to the parties. I like some dressed up monkey in a cage and I play my accordion. Oh, but when the wine seeps through the facade, it's nothing but the same old story. Oh, it's nothing but the same old story. Say, hey, Johnny, can't wait till Saturday night. Got a thirst that's raging. No place where we can put that right. Wash away the frustration. Hose down this fire inside, but look out. I said, look out, cause I'll tear you into pieces if you cross me. Don't come too close. Not too close. I got a brother in Boston. Says he sent me on the fair, just wrote me a letter, making out that he's cleaning up all the 2 cars in the driveway. Summer house way down on the Cape, and I know he fixed me up in the morning. I've been thinking about it, but it seems so far to go. People say in the winter that you get lost underneath the snow. And this is girl from my home place. We've been planning to move back and give it a try, so I never got around to go out. Look out! Birds, look out! Birds, look out! Don't come too close, not too close.
Most of the songs I've written since would not have been written if I hadn't spent 10 years doing nothing but Irish music, because like the whole melodic structure or the whole melody thing was very, very strong. And I don't notice it so much myself now, but people point out to me all the time that when I sing, there are inflections, even when I'm singing sort of in a different idiom altogether, like rock music or whatever. There are inflections which carry over into my singing style, which makes it unique. And I know where that comes from. It comes from Irish music, definitely.
The slow air in Irish music is a song without words. It encapsulates the spirit of Irish music at its most elemental.
The slow air is an instrumental, sort of non-metrical tune which has words attached to it. There's a wonderful contrast between the depth of these airs and the vivacity and excitement of the dance music. So it brings out another side, I think, of the Irish musical psyche, perhaps.
When I hear pipers play slow airs, there's a great loneliness in them.
There is, and you know the word uigness, which is sometimes used there, which is roughly translated as loneliness. But uigness, I think, is actually a pleasant feeling. It's a kind of a pleasant sorrow. And you find that, I think, as well in the playing of some dance music. Actually, for all of the speed, you can still have it shot through with a certain uigness. But that uigness certainly comes through in the airs. There's a particularly beautiful one called An Páistín Fionn, The Little Fair-Haired Child. It's a love song, and it was originally a song with Irish lyrics. It's still sung in Irish, but in the 19th century, presumably, a set of English words appear to it as well in sort of Irish style. It's a love song with a chorus. In Irish, it's it's Tusa Maroon, Maroon, Maroon. You are my loved one, my loved one, my loved one. And it ends up in, as we call it, Hiberno-English, as you are my delight, my delight, my delight. And it's a delight in the word delight as well. In fact, that catches you. I think the chorus goes, I'm no singer. You are my delight, my delight, my delight. You are my delight and my darling. You are my delight and my comfort at night. And I'll roll you nine times before morning.
The ballad is very much linked to the English language in Ireland. As any scholar of this area will tell you, English language ballads abound in this country, but Irish language ballads don't. For some reason or other, the Irish language never really took on the whole narrative text. Now, there are like medieval examples of narrative texts in Irish and oceanic poetry and all of that. But basically, perhaps it's a split in the Irish mind, language-wise. When the Irish speaker sings and makes a song text, he speaks of love, he speaks lyrically, he speaks of the now, and it's all linked to feeling and emotion, I think, and of course a very strong sense of place.
Could you give me an example of a song like that?
Well, I mean, if you take a song like Band Over Glanna, The Dark Woman of the Glen, the text begins, Tá bógam ar a sliabh, is táim le seal na díag, ó chailis am a chéal an óchar, which translates as, I have a cow on the mountain. I have been herding it for some time, and I have been following it, and my mind is lost, has lost its reason. It goes on, I wander east, I wander west, I go to the places where my love was, and I am distraught. Now, it doesn't actually go back then and say, it was in March that I met her, and then we sort of got engaged, and then whatever. There's no narrative quality in it. It's picking up on the emotion of sort of unrequited love or lost love. And anybody who studies, for example, balladry in Ireland, in the English language, has to study balladry in North America and in Australia as well. You have to see the tradition of ballads in Ireland in an international English language context, I think, to understand them.
So how's the van?
Great, no problems.
Good.
Right. Well.
In the contemporary American ballad, one can still hear echoes of the music of the Scots-Irish. John Prine is of Appalachian extraction. The Appalachian Hill Country was an area where hardship, deprivation, and loss were commonplace. John Prine's ballad, Paradise, about the family home in Muhlenberg County, is true to that tradition.
All the families from Muhlenberg County, and her dad raised us like as if we were from there, and any time his ship came in, he was going to take us all back down there again. But by the time we were kind of in our teenage years, they'd already bought, well, I was in the Army, actually, over in Germany, and he wrote me a letter and told me that Peabody Coal had bought up the town and tore it down, and he could never take me back there again, so I wrote this song just after I got out of the Army.
I was a child of a family down in western Kentucky, where my parents were born. Hometown that's often remembered so many times. Daddy, won't you take me back to Muhlenberg County and the Green River where paradise lives? Well, I'm sorry, Master, Mr. Peabody's coal train is all it was. Well, sometimes we travel right down the Green River to the where the air smell like snakes, and we'd shoot with our best bottles with all we would kill. And Daddy won't care down by the Green River where paradise lay. My son, but you're too late and ask Mr. Peabody's coal train. Company came with the world's largest shovel. They tore it and it stripped all the land. They dug for the pillar of land was forsaken. And then they wrote it all down as a prophet. Daddy, won't you take me back to Muhlenberg County, paradise land? Well, I'm sorry, my son, but Peabody's coal train is the holiday away. Thank you.
I went a dialing my ass roll on up to Rochester, Maine. I'll be happy just 5 miles away from wherever I am. Take me back to Muhlenberg County, down by the Green River. Well, I'm sorry, my son, but you're too late to ask the Mr. Peabody's gold train is the holiday way. The Mr. Peabody's gold train is the holiday way.
Emmylou Harris, Mary Black, and singing traditions. The ballad is their common ground.
Get off my nose.
Originated into a richly harmonized accompanied song form.
Send away, I'm here all alone. Your daddy's a sailor. Nights are so long.
To the traditional ballads, but do they differ greatly in form?
But it tells stories in different ways, I think. If you think of parallel traditions, if you think of the novel or something, you know, the 20th is much more to do with what's going on in the mind, and there's much less. I think the song theme is the same as that. It's eternal, and you know, the emotions are very much pent up and inside. It's also in the writing. There's a lot more that you leave out. I think whereas you used to be able to sing a ballad of 20 or 30 verses, no trouble. I think in 3 or 4 minutes, And so in three or four verses, you have to, quite a lot, you have to suggest a bigger picture than you're actually showing. Keyhole effect, you know, you look through the keyhole and you see a little bit of something and you realize there's a...
Give me a blues song and fade down the light. What man can be said tonight? Just wait while the sweet violins and the cymbals. You don't know me, but can't we pretend to reach the end? One step for aims for dreamers and losers in love. And two steps for crime, lost in love. Oh, they say love's for gamblers. Oh, the pen and the lost everything. So don't saddle the memories and we'll drink in the dawn. Oh, time for a good folding money.
Now she sings in a contemporary style.
Waltzing's present one step for sign.
And these two strains of contemporary and traditional are often found together.
And yet it is, in some senses, in the technical sense, a third world country, Europe, geographically. But on the other hand, it has been a Western country which still has its rural tradition. So we're linked, and yet we have this older rural tradition existing in the cities. It's transferred from the country. It's almost like as if it's coming home.
If your life is a rough bit, it's a slave to man's whips and man's jeep. Justice and right in your eyes, faint as the singing feels warmer for the spark of a day when fear will lose its grip
and heaven has its way. Dream will realize, heaven knows. No frontiers, and I've seen heaven in your eyes. Heaven knows, no frontiers, and I've seen heaven in your.
The ballad is fundamental to the American and Irish tradition of song-making. It looks set to endure in the popular music of the West. It still has a function. Ballads which tell the story of the Irish experience of emigration are still being written.
There's so many songs of Irish emigration and related to the themes of Irish settlement too in America that are around that it's almost a bewildering array of different material from different times, and it's hard to make sense of it all. But there's only one song that I know of that's written from the language of emigrant letters, and not just in Irish culture in America, but to the best of my knowledge in any ethnic culture in this country. And it's a very interesting and almost surreal story. A man called Peter Jones in Washington, D.C., came across letters in his own family history, and they'd been written from a town in the west of Ireland in County Mayo called Kilkelly to members of the family over here in America. And he took those letters and fashioned a song using the language of the letters. And I came to hear a very chilling tale about his own family in recent times, that the great-grandfather who received those letters had 9 children in the New World here who all died in 1 week in an epidemic. That was very common here, that major epidemics would sweep through a community and destroy people. And he wrote, I'd say, the most eloquent and poignant tale of what it was like to be separated and the loneliness of it and the despair of it that I've come across in this country. And he called it Kilkelly.
Kilkelly, Ireland, 1860.
my dear and loving son John. Your good friend, schoolmaster Pat McNamara, so good as to write these words down. Your brothers have all got to find work in England. House is so empty and sad. The crop of potatoes is sorely infected, a third to a half of them bad. And your sister Bridget and Patrick O'Donnell are going to be married in June. Mother says not to work on the railroad, be sure to come on home soon. Kilkelly, Ireland, 1870, my dear and loving son John. Hello to your missus and to your four children, may they grow healthy and strong. Michael has got in a wee bit of trouble, I suppose that he never will learn. Because of the dampness there's no turf to speak of, and now we have nothing to burn. And Bridget is happy, you named the child for her, although she's got six of her own. You say you found work, but you don't say what kind, or when you'll be coming home. Sad news that your dear old mother has gone. We buried her down at the church in Kilkelly. Brothers and Bridget were there. You don't have to worry, she died very quickly. Remember her in your prayers. And it's so good that Michael's returning with money, he's sure to buy land. For the crop has been poor and the people are selling at any price that they can. I suppose that I must be close on 80. It's 30 years since you're gone. Because of all of the money you sent me, I'm still living out of my own. Michael has built himself a fine house, and Bridget's daughters are grown. And thank you for sending your family picture, your lovely young women and men. You say that you might even come for a visit. What joy to see you again. my dear brother John. I'm sorry I didn't write sooner to tell you that father passed on. He was living with Bridget. She says he was cheerful and healthy right down to the end. Now you should have seen him playing with the grandchildren of Pat McNamara, your friend. And we buried him alongside of mother down at Kilkelly churchyard. He was a strong and a feisty old man, considering his life was so hard. And it's funny the way he kept talking about you. He called for you at the end. Oh, why don't you think about coming to visit? We'd all love to see you again.